On today's show, actress, comedian Judy Gold, and Alice from the Brady Bunch, and political activist and comedy writer Henriette Mantel. And then we talk with Robin Urevich from Capital in Maine, as well as Newsweek, her new investigative piece about labor violations committed by Donald Trump's pick for Secretary of Labor.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Oh, no, I shouldn't have said it, because now I'll...
Okay. All right, we're rolling. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Well, this is the best show of the month. Former President Barack Obama sits down with me for the hour to talk about life after the presidency. And when President Obama said that he was going to come in, I got a call from Woody Allen. And I've been trying to get Woody on the show since the beginning. He didn't want to do it. Slayton almost got Woody to come in, but Woody wouldn't. It was impossible. But when Barack Obama said he would do the show, Woody said he would come in and talk comedy with Barack Obama. So that's our show. I've got a family emergency. It's my sister calling. Hang on, I got to take this call. Susie?
Yeah, David.
Hi. I'm in the middle of my show.
Hi. I'm back in New York.
Oh,
from New York.
Oh, from Washington. Right. Oh, how? All right.
Oh my God, it was great. I mean, it was pretty much really pretty great, and Mom marched with all the, you know, gray panthers, and I was so proud of her, you know, and they were all marching together, and I was, like, kind of behind them, and it was good. It was really good. It was really good.
And she, you know, at her age, did you take care of her? Because that's a big thing for her.
Oh, my God. Oh, totally. No, I took care of her. I had her Depends there. I had her water bottle. I had extra pants for her. I had everything. It was all good. And then
people love her. She's just
they
a real
were not excited. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
They love her. She's great. No, they love her. She's great. And they were really all excited to be there. But
yeah,
you know,
she's filled with fire and brimstone, right?
Well, yeah. Well, yes and no. At one point, she thought she saw Daddy, and she kind of meandered a little bit off to the side, even though he's been, you know, dead for a long time. And she thought he was there, and she thought he was sitting there.
I've often seen the Washington Monument, and it reminds me of Daddy.
Yeah. I should know that. But, I mean, I think...
What do you mean? What do you mean you should know that?
She thought he was on the stage with the president at one point, and she kind of, you know, meandered that way. And
tell me the good news. I need good. I'm really depressed about Trump, and I'm really proud, Susie, that you and Mommy made your voices heard.
Yeah.
So and you went down there and you stood up for democracy. So tell me, I just need good news. Just tell me, I'm so sad right now.
It's all good news. She got on the podium. She got on the stage with all the Republicans and Trump, and I couldn't get on because I didn't have an ID, and I don't know why she talked her way into it. But next thing you know, it was really crowded down there, and you know, David. To make a long story short, have you heard from her?
No,
I
only talk to her once every 3 months.
Well, okay, so I came back to New York thinking that, you know, she would come back with all her friends, all the Grey Panthers on that bus, and I couldn't find her, so I just hopped on another bus thinking that she would be on the other bus, and then when I got here, she didn't get off the Grey Panther bus, and I've not seen her. I don't know.
What do you mean you haven't seen her? You're supposed to.
No.
You brought
last time I saw her, I gave her a clean pair of pants, and she put them on, and she went to the podium, and I haven't seen her since she went up on the stage.
Wait.
Talk to Mo.
Wait a second, mommy. So if I were to call, I mean, I'm not scheduled to call mommy for another 48 days. If I called her,
try to get a hold of her. I don't know if her phone's working. She doesn't really understand her phone, so she kind of doesn't really get it when it goes off and stuff. So I don't know.
But you talk to mommy.
This is what I've done. I called the park police, and they have a picture of her, and they're looking for her. And they say there's a lot of old people that got disoriented that day.
Susie,
a lot of people that have marched for a long time, and they all got disoriented. So she's not the only one missing.
Susie,
so I feel positive that we're going to be able to find her. I think she just probably is with a group of people that she probably doesn't know who they are.
Wait a second. You call mommy 6 times a day. That's our agreement, right?
I know.
Right?
Yeah.
And yeah. I told you since my mother that...
What? You call her once in a while.
I do. Every 3 months.
You're the beloved son. She always likes you better than me anyway.
Okay,
I don't know where she is. She thinks daddy's down there in working for Trump or something. I don't know what her problem is with that. She's hallucinating. And I don't know what else to say. I can't find her.
Okay, first of all,
I've got everybody out after her right now.
Okay.
I've given everybody my phone number. Hopefully she'll be calling.
Susie, first of all, it was your idea 20 years ago not to tell mommy that daddy died. I went along with that. So she's looking for him.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Hey, I got a call. Yeah. Hang on. Can you stay on the line, Susie?
Yeah.
There's another call. Hello?
You're not even worried.
Hello?
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 Who's this?
Hello?
Who's this? Who's this?
David.
Who's this?
Who is this? You have to ask who it is?
Mom, it's Susie. I'm here.
Don't even. Is that Susie?
Oh, it's mommy. It's my mother.
Where are you?
Where am I? Oh, now you're worried where I am? Now you're worried where I am. I have been wandering. J Street, K Street, M Street. I turn around 1 second, I look back. She's gone. I don't even know. Mom, thank God I have a credit card.
Mom, last time I saw you, you were walking towards the stage and you were talking some Secret Service guy into letting you go up. Because you said Daddy was up there because he was going to be Secretary of State.
Obviously, you have dementia because I don't understand where you would get that story from. I'm in some lobby of some place, and the phone's ringing. I don't even know where the hell I am. Let me tell you something, Susie. I did everything for you. I did everything for you. Everything. You weren't invited to anyone's bat mitzvahs. You cried. I sat there with you, telling you that you only need one friend. Okay? I have done so much, and I taught both of you, David as well, about... how important it is to stand up for your rights and to be loyal, and how disloyal you are for leaving me in Washington. I don't even know where the hell I am. Thank God for the Holocaust Museum, because I went in and they gave me a place to sleep in one of the trains. And I mean, thank God.
I slept in the cattle car. Were the paper clips there?
No, it was the shoes. It's the shoes. Thank God I took some shoes. First of all, who leaves their mother? How long has it been since you've seen me? What is today?
Two days.
Sunday?
3 days.
Tuesday? What is today?
It's Friday.
I've called the hospitals. David, why don't you just shut up?
You called hospitals? Hospitals.
Yeah. I didn't know where
That's
you
where
were.
You called.
I've been trying
as
to
if
find
I,
you.
As if a, did I march? Did I march?
Where? Yes, you did march with your walking and everything. And I was like, where's your I fallen and I can't get up necklace?
I've fallen and I can't get up necklace bracelet. when I'm around hundreds and thousands and millions of people. Why? Because if I'm going to fall, someone will be there to get me up. But it's not going to be my daughter, is it? It's not going to be my daughter. And that's what I'm talking about. And you and David, David calls me once, what, once every 3 months?
Yeah.
Once every 3 months.
Yeah. How he's horrible. That's why, because he's a bad
How
son.
I protected him. Protected him.
All right, I'm in the...
I know, you protected
you know
him, so he's a little spoiled baby that never does anything.
Okay.
He never even comes
Susie,
to see you. He never
you know, I'd rather
you.
Have someone who checks in once every 3 months and is pleasant to me.
Thank you.
Than to be with someone...
Thank you.
Who is...
David, you're
obviously, you don't care. How many days later is it now?
It's
what is it, February?
Three, four, five.
It's Friday.
No,
it's already February.
It's 6 days.
You thought Dad was on the new Secretary of State. What was I supposed to do?
Oh, that was a joke. I was joking.
All right.
You can't tell that I'm joking?
Okay. All right.
I suppose you were joking when you told me.
You see the attitude,
I suppose you were joking.
You
told me that you were marching with Rosie O'Donnell, too.
Susie?
Excuse me?
Susie.
I don't even understand this, yeah. David. Do you understand this? None of this makes any sense. All I know is that I'm in Washington, D.C., okay? I'm going
all
over
right,
to
I'm
Union
gonna get
Station.
You a car. I'm going to get you an Uber.
I don't want a goddamn car!
Well, how are you going to get home?
I will get a train ticket. I will come home. And you know what? Both of you. You can both go shove it up your ass.
All right,
okay?
Susie.
Because I don't
train
need it.
The got on was in the hall. Museum. I don't want you to go and get them on one of those trains again.
Okay, Susie, why do you upset mommy this way? Why are you
exactly, David?
Why are you upset?
It's all about. I turned around.
Happy.
She couldn't wait to get away from me. She couldn't wait to get away from me.
Oh my God, that's so not true. I was total. Look, I'm walking 25 feet behind you with your freaking diaper bag, right?
Okay.
That's what I was
saying. Excuse me.
You're always so mean to me.
Excuse me.
I had your diaper
they are
bag.
Not diapers.
I had
they
your
are not diaper
diapers. Bag.
They are not diapers. They are poise. They are called poise, okay? Not diapers. I have leakage.
Whatever they're called.
Who
I was
have
carrying
leakage
them.
At my age? I'm marching.
All right.
You think I'm going to go
I
into
know,
one of those
were having a good time. Time.
All right, Susie.
You were having a good time
diapers.
Until you decided that Daddy was
I
on the podium.
I have diapers.
Susie,
oh,
why are you Susie? You go out of your way to make mommy angry. Just back
oh my
up.
God,
that's right,
so
David.
True, David.
That is absolutely
such,
right.
That's so not true,
he comes,
David.
He calls
you're the
me
one that never calls.
Every 3 months,
visit. He calls. Yeah, every 3 months, I call you every single day
okay.
to make sure you're
really?
Doing okay.
Except for the past
yeah.
how many days?
Right.
Except for
well,
how,
I've been trying to get you, and your phone's
day.
Out of battery.
Really? Did you notice
you don't have your iPhone and
oh.
I can't get up?
Oh, did you say, oh, she's not answering the phone. Maybe there's a problem. Meanwhile, I'm walking
Mommy,
around
I called the cops.
Washington, D.C.
The...
Do you know there are some areas of Washington, D.C. that are not safe?
So, Susie, why don't you
oh,
just...
Oh, my God.
Susie, why don't you just... I'm in the middle of my show. Can you just apologize to Mommy?
Oh, David.
David, why don't you shut up? That's what I say. Why don't you just shut up
okay.
and stay
no,
out of
David,
it?
I
you
have to say,
ever, and
you
yes,
and
oh,
this
oh,
goddamn...
You send a check every month. Oh, that's a big deal. Well, you know what? You can't buy her love by sending a check and calling her every month.
You know, I must say, Susie...
I'm the main
I must say, he is very busy with his show. And, you know, and I ask him, Susie, I agree with you on that.
What?
That he has this sort of, you know, this show.
Yeah.
Where do you listen to the show? Do I put on the television? There's no show. Do I put on the radio? Yeah. There's no show. I have no idea what this
no,
show is. And I'm the crazy one? And I'm the guy, I can't come. I have a show. What show? What show? What the hell
nobody
is the show?
Listens to his show?
What I want to watch
nobody
a show.
Listens.
I put on a show.
Yeah, David, nobody listens to your show. It's a waste of time. So why don't you come to...
Where
you
is
what,
the show? I've asked Susie, I have asked... it must be every time I speak to him, every 3 months, where do I hear the show? Where do I go to watch the show? My friends, what's David doing? What's David doing? Oh, he's doing the show. What show? What show?
That's a good question.
Exactly.
Hey, David.
So, Susie.
Hey, David, what are you doing? Masturbating in the corner instead of doing a show?
Don't even bring that up.
Remember
don't
when he
bring that
take the hand off his, you know what?
Oh,
all
please, the amount
days,
of time.
Okay. Take his hand off it. It was so
I walked in there. Susie, I walked in one day.
Is there a mute? Can you turn
it? Because it was every single day at 4:30.
I know.
And I walk in.
It was really embarrassing.
Can you turn her
down? Susie, I haven't told you the worst. I walked in.
What?
Of
please.
Course, he's doing it.
Oh, stop.
And he is looking at a photo of me when I was younger.
Of who?
Oh. You were attractive.
You
were beautiful. Mommy, you were beautiful.
I saw him. He was holding a photo of me.
Oh, my God. Oh
when
my
I was
God.
At one of the, you know, I was
David,
at the pool at the Concord.
Therapy.
Yes. I'm at the pool in the Concord.
Was,
I'm wearing a bathing suit.
It was Betsy.
It was Betsy.
Did
we get your father?
Betsy was in the
and
photograph.
And he was whacking off to you, Mom?
No.
Betsy
was in the photograph with you applying suntan lotion.
David.
It was,
yeah,
no.
David.
The fact that I'm even in the photo.
I wasn't looking on my I hand to God.
You weren't attracted to Betsy. You were attracted to Mom.
No, can we get back to how, Mommy?
It's been years of this. I've been holding this in that my son has an issue.
Oh.
He has an issue.
Oh no! Kidding.
And
no kidding.
And it's horrible for a parent.
Yeah.
Can we get back to how Susie?
For a parent,
so gross.
Susie abandoned you in Washington.
Why were you doing it?
Susie abandoned
you,
Mommy. Susie abandoned you in Washington D.C. and left you there for 5 days at the Holocaust Museum. You abandoned her, and she had to sleep in a cattle car at the Holocaust Museum. Let's get back to that.
You know what? She was sitting in the lobby at the Mayflower. She was very happy.
Susie.
What?
The goodwill
what?
That we've gotten to some goodwill, and I would stop right now if I were you.
Okay, I'm going to stop right now.
All right,
Mommy, you're okay.
David, you know what? No one listens.
Am I okay?
Anymore. Hang on, Mommy.
Who's picking me up at Amtrak?
Okay.
Who's going to pick
Susie,
me up an Amtrak
I'll
today?
I'll be there.
Thank
don't
you,
worry.
Susie.
All right. Okay.
Fine. That'll be perfect. David,
and
you do your what do they call it now? The show?
Yeah.
They call them the pump.
You do the
pump,
show.
Blockers.
I mean, it is embarrassing.
They don't call them radio. No one can even find it. You Google them, it's like, who? There's like 8 million David Feldman.
Right.
I don't even know.
I have to wrap
up.
It's such a waste.
You're waiting.
Paying for him to go to Columbia was the biggest waste of money. Where'd I go?
Don't bring that up. I will have a stroke. Do not bring that up. I will have a stroke.
Okay.
I
have to wrap it up. Mommy, I'm scheduled to talk to you, I think, in 44 days. But since we've already talked, I'm going to bump that up.
No.
To 62 days. In 62 days, I'll check in on you. Okay?
David, if she has a stroke, it's your name on the gravestone. Okay?
You're the one giving her a stroke.
Susie,
I will be. Oh, God damn it, both of you. Listen to me.
I'll tell her.
God damn it, David.
No, I'm going to tell
Susie.
Susie.
I'll be in at 717.
Susie.
The 717. The 717. I will be at the 717.
Okay, I'll be there. I'll pick you up.
You're going to pick her up? Because if you don't pick her up.
David, you think you're going to pick her up? You're too busy doing your fake radio show that no one listens to. It's imaginary.
That I have to listen to this shit, and I have to still listen to the two of them fighting. You think after it? Do you understand that, Susie? I will see you at 7:17.
Yes. Okay,
David.
Okay, all right. Love you,
ashamed.
Mom. I love you,
Mommy.
I love you, Mommy.
You're a jerk. I love both of you.
I love you, Mommy. I love Mom. You love me unconditionally, Mommy. Mommy.
Yes, I love both of you unconditionally, equally.
That was great. Let me stop. Did Henriette...
Wait, what about how I slept in cattle car at the Holocaust Museum?
That was good. Henriette hung up. This is Judy Gold, by the way, to my listeners. That was great.
Oh.
That was
how... Thank you. Oh, Henriette's calling me right now.
Oh, tell her. Okay, that was Henriette Mantel, who is an activist as well as an actress. She played... She played
him.
What?
Oh my God! Oh my God! That was so
funny. It was perfect. It was perfect.
Oh my God! Oh, okay. Well, that was fun. Oh my God! When you said I'm gonna, how about when I sit up here in your diaper bag? You said they're not diapers; they're boys. And then I tell you, being dad, you're going to pick you up with your phone. Oh my God. Okay, I got to go back to work. Thank you. Love you both.
I owe you jokes, right?
Yeah, you owe me. Yeah, I'll let you know. In a day or two, I'll let you know where, when, how. You too.
What?
Okay, love you. I got to go to work. I'm trying to punch up this show I'm doing, and not my show, a different show, a work show.
Okay.
And I need three jokes.
Okay, right, I'll help
okay.
you.
I'll talk to you later.
I love you, Henriette. Bye. That was great. Judy, you're still there?
Yes. Hello? Okay.
Did she hang up?
Yeah.
Okay, that was Judy Gold and Henriette Mantel. Coming up, we're going to talk about Donald Trump's cabinet pick for Secretary of Labor, Andrew Puzder. Teresa Holcomb Gammon, I hope I'm pronouncing that name properly, a comedian who started about 10 years after I did in San Francisco, a young friend, Holy City Zoo, very inventive comedian. She said something really funny that I just have to quote. She gave me permission to use this. I had made a joke that Donald Trump keeping Martin Luther King's bust in the Oval Office. And she said, yeah, because he needs some place to hang his hairpiece. Now, that is just such a great joke, isn't it? Because it's the image of Donald Trump, you know, walking into the Oval Office, taking off his toupee and putting it on Martin Luther King's bust. What a great joke. That is a perfect image. Teresa Holcomb Gammon. I hope I'm pronouncing her last name. The Women's March, we were talking about that early. The numbers were amazing. I got so many numbers. It was incredible. Looks like Donald Trump is about to give Calista Gingrich a job, but not the kind of job Calista used to give Newt while Newt was still married to somebody else. I'm absolutely appalled by what's going on in this country. And I would stop paying taxes, but I'm afraid then ExxonMobil would make me president the same way they did with Donald Trump. Well, we got to get rid of Donald Trump, although I really want to wait till he's 500 pounds before we throw him out. I just want to see him balloon up because, you know, he's not having sex with Melania. You know, the Secret Service is watching him, so he can't assault anybody. So he's just going to eat and eat and eat. This is a man who can not only dish it out, but dish it in as well. So you got to respect him for that. Why, is that unfair? Because I've been told you can't make jokes about Melania. I said something like, well, at least Melania will be safe because the Secret Service can witness any abuse. And somebody said, no, you cannot make fun of Melania. She's a woman, and jokes about domestic abuse are not funny. They're not. But I do think she's a victim of abuse. You can't make jokes about Melania. And you can't make jokes about Barron Trump, his 10-year-old kid. This writer from SNL got suspended, maybe fired, because she tweeted on a personal account a joke that Barron Trump is going to end up being the world's first homeschool shooter. There was a petition on change.org 400,000 people signed it for SNL to fire this female writer. Her last name is Rich. I don't know if she's fired, but I know she's been suspended for tweeting something in her own personal account. My response to that is First Amendment, and secondly, hey, there's an opening for a writer at SNL. No, that is, she has to be given her job back. I love the way that more press has been devoted to that tweet and how president's 10-year-old kid is off limits and people are wringing their hands and how bad it is for Barron Trump to have jokes made about him. No mention that 23% of American children live in poverty. That we don't talk about. The third rail when it comes to children is we have to protect Barron Trump. Yeah, of course it's wrong to make that joke. But she shouldn't have been fired. She shouldn't have made that joke. And we shouldn't be talking about Barron Trump. Nobody should be talking about Barron Trump. We should be talking about 23% of American children live in poverty because we are a third world nation. You don't know it because they won't tell you that on TV, but we're a third world nation. And now we have Donald Trump, who could have been any banana republic dictator from the 70s. And by the way, Paul Krugman, 5 years ago in the New York Times, wrote that the gap between the wealthy and poor in America, the gap, exceeds any Latin American country during the heyday of banana republics. We used to talk about the income inequality that was going on in Latin America. It's worse in America than it ever was in Latin America. We were talking about income inequality in this country and the rise of Donald Trump. And I remembered a book by Naomi Klein called, I believe it was called The Shock Doctrine. Milton Friedman and the Straussians from University of Chicago in the 70s came up with this idea called the Shock Doctrine. You take advantage of a crisis like hyperinflation or a coup d'etat, seize control of the finances, you privatize all government services. This is what Milton Friedman and the Straussian Ayn Rand economists from the 70s invented. And they practiced this in Chile with Pinochet. When Pinochet overthrew Allende, Milton Friedman encouraged what was called the Shock Doctrine, which said privatize public services. Privatize the railways, turn them over to private companies, the post office, the water, give it to private companies because they can run it better. That's what the economic wing of the Republican Party believes in. They believe in privatization of government services, and the best way to implement that, to get that rammed through, is to use a crisis. They use 9/11 for tax cuts, privatize Social Security. The problem that the Republicans have had for the past 8 years is that Barack Obama did a pretty good job, and there was no crisis. The whole idea of the Shock Doctrine is during a crisis, we're so overwhelmed, we don't notice what's being taken away from us. Donald Trump is the shock. He is inheriting a pretty good economy, bad jobs, but relative peace. Donald Trump is the shock. Every day, he is going to continue to shock us because that is why he was put there by ExxonMobil, by the dark forces who have once again installed a president the same way they installed George W. Bush. And all Donald Trump has to do is shock us. We are supposed to be shocked and overwhelmed by all this so that we can't think straight. And then the dark forces, ExxonMobil, they move in and they grab it all. Milton Friedman, Strauss, the University of Chicago, they invented this. take advantage of a crisis when the system has been shocked, the citizens, their guard is down, you can take what's yours. Obama did a pretty good job. We're in good shape. So they gave us Trump, who is supposed to continue to shock us and overwhelm us. Read Naomi Klein's book. It explains what the shock doctrine is. And my advice to you is not to be shocked, because that's Donald Trump's job. His job is to shock you. Instead of being shocked, go to fivecalls.org and methodically call your congressperson and your senator each day, fivecalls.org, each day, 5 minutes. That's all you have to do to make your voice heard. You go to fivecalls.org, punch in your zip code. They not only tell you who your congressman is, who your senator is, they give you their phone number and a script. They tell you what to say. And you can paraphrase it or just read it word for word.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
The war against the planet and the working man continues. Donald Trump, who, as we all know, lost the popular vote to Hillary Clinton by 3 million votes, announced on Tuesday that he will reverse President Obama's decision and will instead go ahead with the Keystone Pipeline, a 1,179-mile pipeline that would carry 800,000 barrels a day from the Canadian oil sands to the Gulf Coast. Now, in order for transnational pipelines to be built, America needs the approval of our State Department, which conveniently is about to be run by Rex Tillerson, or as I call him, Rex Spillerson, the CEO of ExxonMobil. Again, go to fivecalls.org. You'll be provided with a script along with the phone number of your congressperson or senator. They'll give you a script, and they'll tell you what to tell your congressperson or senator about Rex Spillerson and why he should not be approved for Secretary of State. So while Donald Trump was signing an executive order authorizing the Keystone Pipeline, he says that he's doing this for jobs. Obama, before he said no to the Keystone Pipeline, estimated that about 2,000 jobs would be created on the construction of the pipeline. Based on the State Department report, that turned out to be false. Far fewer than 2,000 jobs would be created by the Keystone Pipeline. And here's the really incredible thing. After construction, the pipeline would employ probably 50 people. 50 people, 50 jobs, 50 long-term jobs coming from the Keystone Pipeline. 50 jobs, unless you count all the guys in hazmat suits cleaning up the spills or people in the healthcare industry paid to take care of lung-related issues stemming from carbon-based pollution. Jobs. Donald Trump is promising us jobs, but what kind of jobs? Well, we're going to talk about his pick for labor secretary and why he's a disaster.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
According to the New York Times, Donald Trump is planning to have the whitest cabinet filled with the most male since Ronald Reagan. If Trump's picks are all confirmed, only 5 low-level cabinet positions would be filled by a woman or a person of color. Andrew Puzder is Trump's pick to run the Department of Labor, mandated to protect America's working people. Puzder is the CEO of CKE Restaurants, which owns Carl's Jr., and Hardee's, along with Red Burrito and Green Burrito shops. According to the investigative online website, Capital in Maine, quote, racial discrimination and sexual harassment claims filed in federal court against Puzder's company and its franchisees read like stories from the 1940s or 50s before civil rights laws were ever enacted. Joining us is the author of those words, Robin Urevich, whose latest piece for Capital in Maine is entitled, Under Labor Secretary Nominee Puzder, Company Hit with Race Discrimination and Sexual Harassment Lawsuits. You can read that over at capitalinmaine.com. Trump has picked Andrew Puzder. He's the CEO of CKE,
Do you know when his confirmation hearings are scheduled?
As far as I know, it's February 2nd. It's been changed a couple times.
What is the Department of Labor, and why was it established? Who's it set up to protect?
Well, the Department of Labor is set up to protect workers. It's set up to enforce laws like occupational safety, OSHA, wage and hour laws, unemployment insurance. There's a Women's Bureau. There's a part of the Department of Labor that's set up to enforce discrimination laws.
Capital in Maine has done a pretty detailed investigative summary of Puzder and his company, and I want to get to that in a few moments. But where does Andrew Puzder stand on minimum wage, on sick leave, Obamacare? Where does he stand on the rights of labor?
Andrew Puzder opposes Obamacare. He opposes a $15 minimum wage. He has not been specific about what kind of wage that he would recommend. He opposed a federal sick leave provision that would provide sick leave to federal employees. He seems to be very opposed to regulation of all types. He's called regulation a tax. Those seem to be his positions.
Why would you put him in charge of labor? Why wouldn't you put him in charge of commerce? Where does he stand on enforcing the laws on the books?
You know, we don't know about that, but that's one of the reasons why we looked into what his record was at CKE restaurants in terms of those things. Well, I can detail for you a little bit about what my piece found out.
Yeah, it's pretty exhaustive research. I'll get to that in a second.
You know, fast food in general has a lot of problems with wage and hour laws.
Mm-hmm.
And Puzder's companies do too. But when you line them up against other fast food companies in terms of wage and hour laws, they don't fare that badly, but it's still, the record is still not good.
Yeah. You write, though, that when it comes to labor violations in the fast food industry, his company is the worst of the worst.
Oh, when it comes to employment discrimination, yes. When we looked at burger chains that did $1 billion of business annually, he was the worst.
He was the worst.
His company was the worst. I mean, when I say he was the worst, that's not exactly correct. But his company had more lawsuits against it when you looked at it as a percentage of sales than any other burger company that had $1 billion in sales or more.
Okay, before we get to that, what is the EEOC?
The EEOC is the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And it's a federal agency that enforces civil rights laws and civil rights laws against workplace discrimination. Those include racial discrimination, nationality, religion, sex, age, disability, gender, you know, those sorts of things. The EEOC is an agency that one goes to if you have a complaint about discrimination. They don't do a lot in terms of enforcement. It's probably a misstatement, but they don't go to court very often. They go to court in less than 1% of cases. Usually what they do is they issue what's called a right to sue letter, saying that a person has exhausted all their administrative remedies so they can look for relief in the courts. But in some cases where they want to send a message to an employer or where they feel like the allegations are very, very egregious, they file a lawsuit themselves.
So they're run by lawyers. I think Anita Hill and Clarence Thomas worked at
the EEOC. Yeah.
Yeah. There was a consent decree for CKE. Is that correct?
There's been several consent decrees. I wrote about two EEOC cases, but we looked overall at, you know, half dozen or so, handful of EEOC cases that were filed and against those companies. I mean, the numbers are so little, but there were more in the years since Andrew Puzder became CEO, which was the year 2000. There were proportionally more EEOC complaints against those companies, Carl's Jr. and Hardee's, than any other burger chain except for Sonic Drive-In, which had more.
I remember the Los Angeles Police Department was working under a consent decree. What does a consent decree mean?
It's where the parties settle a case short of going to trial. In some cases here, the company had to say that they would not discriminate, that they would set up, for example, sexual harassment training or anti-discrimination training. They had to pay out a settlement to the employees.
a consent decree with a fast food franchise. What does that mean?
In the ones that I looked at, it looked like they were answering to the EEOC for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. You know, they would set up a period of time in which they had to show that they had provided the trainings that they had agreed to provide, and they had to show that they had a complaint procedure, had to show when employees came forward with complaints, that sort of thing. That would be supervised for 2 years if the company complied. If it didn't comply, then there was an option to extend.
The hearings are coming up. He's going to claim plausible deniability. He's going to claim he ran CKE, but he can't control the franchisees.
Yes.
So what is a franchise? I know that McDonald's owns some of their restaurants, but some of those other restaurants are owned by franchisees.
Yes.
What is a franchisee?
And that's the same thing with CKE. A franchisee is a person who says, well, I'd like to run a Carl's Jr. myself, and you sort of borrow the business model. You know, you have to use the logo, you have to use the uniforms, you have to run it sort of like all of the other corporate stores. You're nominally an independent business person. Now, there was a National Labor Relations Board case that held that the parent company or the franchisor was responsible for labor policies. And the courts have come down on different sides. It's not a matter that's settled. Like I said in my story, the Obama administration was a supporter of the joint employer rule, essentially saying that a franchisor also had responsibility because they could dictate policies to the franchisees.
The National Labor Board. What is the National Labor Board? Trump is going to pick somebody to head the National Labor Board. Under Obama, you're saying that they issued a ruling that said a corporation can be held responsible for the labor violations of the franchisees.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And while the National Labor Relations Board is not related to the allegations in this story, the National Labor Relations Board oversees unionization efforts.
This is still tied up in the courts. One court ruled that the National Labor Board was correct in holding corporate headquarters accountable for the activities of the franchise.
Yeah, I'm not sure of the court rulings in the case, but I do know that this is something that's not settled, and it's still going on. And other judges, like just coincidentally, and not exactly coincidentally, but when I was looking at lawsuits in other areas for this story, there was an accident where a person was badly hurt at a Hardee's restaurant in West Virginia. And the judge in that case would not dismiss the claims against the parent company, you know, saying that he believed they were a joint employer. So different kinds of, in different types of cases, this has come up. And like I said, it's not settled, but it's definitely true that a franchisor can dictate a lot of policies to its franchisees.
But he's going to say it's a states' rights thing.
Well, I don't know about states' rights, but I think they're going to say that.
What I'm saying is that he's going to say, you know, as the CEO of this company, we can't dictate to the franchisees.
Exactly. They're going to say that these are independent business people, and they've touted this model as, you know, something where a person can kind of pull themselves up by their own bootstraps and have their own private business and that kind of thing.
Well, they say the fish rots from the head down. How bad is the culture over at CKA? What is your exhaustive investigative research over Capital in Maine?
Well, I wish I knew a lot more about the culture from the inside, and I think that's something that I'd love to hear more about if you have anybody in your audience who knows. But one of the things that we did do was we did do a very exhaustive look at federal court cases against the company in the area of employment discrimination. And those were the ones that I focused on were mostly racial discrimination cases and sexual harassment cases that were filed in federal court since Andrew Puzder became CEO.
And were they filed against CKE or were they filed against individual franchisees?
Well, the cases that I wrote about, with the exception of two of them, were filed against the company. The first one that I wrote about, mm-hmm, was filed against CKE and Carl's Jr. The others were against Hardee's. Those are corporate-owned restaurants that I wrote about. There were two cases that I wrote about that were cases where managers alleged that they were told to discriminate. For example, there was one manager that had been with the company for 21 years, and she's African-American. She said that her boss came to her and told her that she would have to hire 90% white workers at a Hardee's store in Alabama because most of the restaurant's clientele were white. And she refused, and then she said that in retaliation she was sent to manage another Hardee's. And then later she was also fired or let go from the company.
What was the final disposition of that?
That was also settled, so we don't know. You know, the settlements are confidential, so we don't know what the final disposition was. You know, the company didn't go to court and instead settled out of court. That's the case with a lot of these cases, with the exception of the ones that had a consent decree with the EEOC, because those are public. And there was another one against a franchisee that's very similar, where another African-American woman who was a pretty long-time manager was told that a white guy was going to make decisions at her store, and then she was pushed out altogether, and the white guy took over as manager. And she said that the reason why that happened was because she was objecting to a new practice at the store of hiring white applicants and ignoring the applications of African-Americans. The majority of cases that I wrote about were against corporate stores, and those two happened to be against franchisees. Like, for example, in this case, this pretty horrible case in Sacramento, a lot of the workers were teenagers, and the EEOC had a program to protect teenage workers, and they felt like that was one of the reasons why they filed in this case near Sacramento.
The cases you described were kind of mild, like the salsa at Red Burrito and Green Burrito.
I mean, what I found really surprising, and maybe I'm naive, but was the way that workers discussed their treatment, especially in terms of racial discrimination. There was this case in 2000 that happened in Elk Grove, California, right outside of Sacramento. There was a young woman who was a teenager at the time, and she alleged that she went to the EEOC. The EEOC filed suit on her behalf, alleging that a company supervisor used the N-word. He bragged that he had a Confederate flag that flew over his house, and he showed his swastika tattoo and other white power tattoos. He bragged that he planned to get another tattoo on his forehead that would show a lynching victim that was African-American. And when this young woman complained to a manager, he apparently told her that he himself was racist. And so, you know, I mean, imagine how a young person like that would feel. So she did go to an attorney. She went to the EEOC. She and her coworkers got a $255,000 settlement, and the company had to agree to a no discrimination policy. But I should say that in this case, as well as in the other cases, there's a pattern, and that is that a person suffers some pretty bad discrimination. Like, there was other allegations at a Hardee's restaurant in Knoxville, Tennessee, where a young man was initially working the takeout window or the drive-thru window. Customers yelled out the N-word at him and other racial slurs. And his supervisor said, "Hey, are you going to take that?" And then soon after that, Page alleges in these court papers that this guy, the boss, would call him the N-word and call him Blackie and Moon and repeatedly insult him. He would say, "Get your black ass back to work." That's a quote from court papers. There was an allegation by this gentleman that the general manager of the restaurant sent him a text. She asked him if he could get texts on his phone, and he said yes. Then she sent him a picture of what appeared to be a KKK lynching. There was a black man that was running from people who were dressed in white robes, and there's a cross burning in the background. So this guy endured this, and then I didn't detail so much of this in my story, but he complained to a trio of upper management, and then he alleged that he was retaliated against for reporting it. And that is the pattern also in some of the sexual harassment cases that I wrote about. That kind of retaliation for reporting, of course, means that people are less likely to report or they're going to lose their jobs. And according to people who I've talked to, attorneys who are experts in sexual harassment, that's exactly what you're not supposed to do. You're supposed to create an atmosphere where people feel comfortable reporting so that you can root out the behavior that's illegal. But in these cases, at least, it seemed that what was done was to minimize what was going on with these people and then to punish them for reporting.
The people who work at a fast food restaurant, they can't afford to eat where they serve. The $15 an hour is not universal.
Well, it doesn't even exist, really. Yeah, only in a few cities. So in these cases, no, people were making just a little bit more than minimum wage, probably.
The EEOC and the Department of Labor was set up to help people who can't buy justice.
Well, yeah. And what's remarkable, too, in some of these cases, I should say, I'm sorry, but what's remarkable in some of these cases is that people actually did go to court and found lawyers to represent them, because people here don't make a lot of money. So say someone is sexually harassed and then eventually either constructively fired or fired, there's not a lot of money at stake. So, you know, a lawyer might not take that case on a contingency basis. They might or they might not, but there's not a lot of money in it. So the fact that these people made it to court is pretty remarkable in itself.
To my listeners who are victims of a corporate climate that condones harassment, do you have a Dropbox? How would people contact you?
Let me try to. If they could email info@capitalandmaine.com, and they could also leave a message at 323-315-7578.
Well, this is part of a three-part investigative series being conducted by Capital in Maine, specifically going after Puzder and the Department of
Looking
Labor.
Looking at Puzder.
And you wrote one of the pieces. There are other pieces out there about Puzder.
Yeah, my colleague Dean Kuipers wrote a piece also about employment, about workers that were unfairly terminated. It looked like they were alleging unfair termination at a bunch of Carl's Jr. stores.
And you can read that over at Capital in Maine. And then the other piece is?
The other piece is a summary of what we found out and what the data showed.
Capital in Maine is an award-winning online publication. You're out of California. You do investigative journalism and cover the intersection of power, politics, and money. When did you join Capital in Maine?
Well, I'm a contributor. I'm a freelancer, just as most of the writers are. And I'm relatively new. I just wrote a piece for them before this in December.
I will link to your article, which is very readable. It could be dry, but the way you wrote it, it's infuriating and factual. You're a journalist. What are your reactions to Trump's assault on reality? I would assume you think that's a bad thing.
I think realities and facts are pretty important.
So you're pro-reality
and
facts.
I'm pro-fact.
Okay. What about alternative facts?
I'm pro-fact, and I think that's why we have a lot of work to do in the next little while to try to make sure that we get the facts out there.
It has been suggested that Trump may be a gift to journalism. You know, subscriptions have gone up to the New York Times, The Nation, all these national magazines. People are now paying for journalism. You know, we used to get it for free. We didn't think it had any value. people are scared and they're paying for journalism. Are we about to embark on a golden age of journalism?
Well, I think we can only hope. I mean, I think there is so much to be investigated. Of course, there always has been. But now more than ever, I think there's a lot that we need to look into, and I think we need to combat efforts to try to keep facts and actions away from the public.
Teach our children internet literacy.
Yeah, absolutely. Real news and fake news.
Robin, I know you're staying on this and that you would like to hear from people who work in the fast food industry who are victims of corporate condoned harassment. How can people reach out to you anonymously and give you information and leads?
Well, people can write to info@capitalinmaine.com. We'd prefer if they don't reach out anonymously. I mean, we'd speak to them about whether or not they want their name used or not. Mm-hmm. That would be a good way to contact us.
And without going to the press, what are your recourses if you're working in the fast food industry? What can you do if you feel you're being harassed?
Well, people can go to file a complaint at the EEOC. And in California, you can go to, I believe it's called the Fair Employment Practices Commission, and file a complaint there. There's also, you can go to the Labor Commissioner if you feel like you're not paid overtime or the proper wages that you're due.
That should take care of it in California? You don't really need to go to the federal government in California, right?
Well,
at least with Jerry Brown as our governor.
You definitely can probably get a decent response at the labor commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't vouch for any of those other agencies, but I think it's definitely worth filing that type of complaint.
I'll link to your article about Labor Secretary nominee Puzder and the race discrimination sexual harassment lawsuits that were generated under his rule over at CKE. Robin Urevich writes for Capital in Maine, capitalinmaine.com. It's an award-winning online publication that reports on the most pressing economic, environmental, and social issues of our time. And I thank you for taking time to talk with us.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
The David Feldman Show is available as a podcast for free on iTunes. For a treasure trove of more free stuff, I invite you to check out davidfeldmanshow.com, where you can find podcasts, radio shows, and reading material dating all the way back to 2009, and it's all free. davidfeldmanshow.com. And while you're over there, I invite you to subscribe to my newsletter. Now, they accuse the liberals of being in a bubble. Maybe we are in a bubble. You know, some of us think politics is fun. Great way to work out our anxiety. Great way to work out our rage. Great way to treat people like crap and then say, hey, but, you know, I voted for Hillary. Some of us are in a bubble. The Republicans are in the real bubble. They tend to live in rural areas where they don't have too much contact with other human beings. That's the ultimate bubble. So this is sent to me by one of our listeners. I'm not going to tell you what his name is, but this is what he said about the climate right now that Donald Trump is creating. A climate that I don't feel because I'm a white male. He writes, David, growing up Mexican, you just kind of get the feeling that white people are constantly questioning your quote unquote legality, judging you harshly if you, say, hold up the line at the market or speak Spanish to your child. It's always just a nagging suspicion that some white people do this. To hear this suspicion confirmed by none other than the president of the country that I was born in is beyond the pale. Were this not really happening, I would call it a nightmare. So if you live in a bubble, you're not aware of the suffering and the fear that Donald Trump right now is creating among the children of undocumented Americans. This is not who our country is. It's just shameful. Meanwhile, Donald Trump is married to a Slovenian who may or may not have come to this country legally. Peter Thiel, the billionaire, Donald Trump's supporter from Silicon Valley, he helped create PayPal, turns out he's seeking citizenship in New Zealand, just as a backup plan. Good for him. I'll pay for the airfare, Peter. Why don't you leave right now? They've installed these young kids to run Voice of America now. Donald Trump is controlling the propaganda machine for Voice of America. NPR, which is basically a disgrace, as is the PBS, they frame the narrative and they don't color out of the lines. They are corporate sponsored. NPR did some hand-wringing about reporting on Donald Trump. Mr. Oreskes, I guess he runs NPR, said, well, you know, the New York Times is calling Donald Trump on his lies, and they're using the word lies. But he says, quote, the minute you start branding things with a word like lie, you push people away from you, unquote. Yeah, NPR. They don't want to push people away from them like they're corporate underwriters. Thank God for the New York Times. Thank God bless the mainstream media right now. They are referring to Donald Trump's statements as lies, that these are inaccuracies because Donald J. Trump is such a pathological liar. The J stands for pathological liar. Meanwhile, on Inauguration Day, The Guardian is reporting that six journalists were slapped with felony rioting charges. Six members of the media, reporters, photographers, videographers, a producer, were detained along with 200 other people on Inauguration Day. They've all been released, but they are facing felony charges. Six journalists. The administration is a week old, and so far six journalists are facing felony charges. Makes sense, considering that Stephen Bannon from Breitbart News is now one of Donald Trump's top political advisors. He's working in the White House. He gave an interview to the New York Times yesterday in which he said the media should keep its mouth shut. Bannon told the New York Times, he said, I want you to quote this. The media here is the opposition party. They don't understand this country. They still don't understand why Donald Trump is the president of the United States, unquote. He goes on to say that the media should be embarrassed and humiliated and keep its mouth shut and just listen for a while. Yeah, that's the purpose of the media, just to listen. He literally says the Democratic Party is not the opposition party. You're the opposition party. The media is the opposition party, unquote. He then went on to say that he's been reading the New York Times for as long as he could read. Let's get back to fivecalls.org. Fivecalls.org. You got to call your congressman. You got to call your senator. Tell them not to vote for Tom Price for Secretary of Health and Human Services. There's been reports now that as a congressman, he traded more than $300,000 in shares of health companies while sponsoring legislation that would benefit those companies. He's from Georgia. He is also a member of the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, AAPS. And that sounds like a reputable organization. They were founded in 1943. Their former leaders were all devotees of Ayn Rand. They were members of the John Birch Society. The lead counsel for them is Andrew Schlafly. He's Phyllis Schlafly's son. They believe, in their statement of principles, the Association of American Physicians believes, quote, it's immoral for physicians to participate in Medicare and Medicaid. If you look at their website, they claim that taxing tobacco harms public health, that electronic medical records are an idea invented by the East German secret police as a form of data control. This is the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, Congressman Tom Price. Trump's pick for Secretary of Health and Human Services belongs to AAPS, an organization on their website They accused Barack Obama of winning the presidency by hypnotizing voters using neuro-linguistic programming, according to the website. The people most vulnerable to neuro-linguistic programming would be writers, young people, educated people, and possibly Jews. So Tom Price, Congressman Tom Price from Georgia, is a quack. He's a doctor, but just because he's a doctor doesn't mean he's smart. He's a member of the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons who believes that Barack Obama won the presidency by hypnotizing young people, writers, educated people, and possibly Jews. And he's going to run Obamacare into the ground. Go to fivecalls.org. They'll give you the script, what to say to your congressman or senator to tell them not to confirm Congressman Tom Price, because he's an idiot. And so is Betsy DeVos. This is somebody who says guns are okay in a classroom because you need one in case you get attacked by grizzly bears. She has no idea how to implement the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, which requires public schools to provide free and appropriate education to all students with disabilities. You think those kids go to private schools? No. I know firsthand. My ex-wife was a public school teacher. When rich people have a child with a disability, they don't send that kid to private school. They dump them into a public school and say, teach them. It's not that overwhelming, folks. Go to fivecalls.org, the number fivecalls.org, and each day you will get an assignment from fivecalls.org, and they will tell you which congressman or senator to call. For example, today, because of fivecalls.org, I am calling my senator, Chuck Schumer. I have a script that is sent to me by Five Calls. I get the email from them. And it's so simple. Senator Ron Wyden said today the most effective way to affect change in America is protest and calling your congressman. So if you go to fivecalls.org, they will tell you not only who to call, but what to say. Now I'm reading the script they gave me. Hi, Senator Chuck Schumer. I'm a concerned U.S. citizen from New York. I'm calling to express my deep opposition to the confirmation of Scott Pruitt to lead the Environmental Protection Agency. Scott Pruitt is a science denier who is in the pocket of the oil and gas industry. He has a long history of protecting corporate profits over the health and safety of the American people, allowing companies such as Devon Energy to write letters in his name on his letterhead. The EPA's role is to protect human health and the environment. Scott Pruitt would be dangerous to this scientific agency and to the American people. Please tell Senator Charles Schumer to oppose the confirmation of Scott Pruitt. Thank you. And the switchboard, the people will take this down. Apparently, according to Republican and Democratic congressional employees calling your senator or congressperson, calling their office and leaving a message, is the second most effective way to make your voice heard. The first most effective way is to protest. And then the third is to vote. But as we all know, in America, it's really hard to vote. People of color are pretty much not allowed to vote. So once again, fivecalls.org. It will simplify your life. 5 calls, 5 minutes a day. You can take back our government without resorting to violence and nonsense and getting angry at people and working out your mental illness. Cannot stress this enough. Politics is not the arena for you to deal with your mental illness. For example, Shia LaBeouf, a very troubled actor and artist, was arrested yesterday, Thursday morning, on misdemeanor assault and harassment charges while protesting Trump in Queens. He was doing an art installation and was live streaming it. Mr. LaBeouf, Shia, has been arrested before. I guess he's a good actor, but he's been having issues, mental health issues. This is not the first time he was arrested. 3 years ago, he went to a performance of Cabaret on Broadway and was arrested for disorderly conduct and criminal trespasses. A lot of liberals are just as guilty as Republicans of working out their rage issues and anger issues through politics. Knock it off. If you're mentally ill, go get help. But don't bring your mental illness, don't bring your paranoia, your rage issues into politics, because you're hurting the cause and you're exploiting. You're exploiting people who really do care about what's going on. That's our show. I want to thank the great Judy Gold and Henriette Mantel, Robin Urevich from Capital in Maine. Thank you for telling us all about Donald Trump's pick for labor. Don't forget to go to 5calls.org. 5 minutes a day. They give you the phone number. They give you the script. Call your congressperson or senator and just read the script and make your voice heard. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. For only $5 a month, you can gain access to our premium content by becoming a monthly subscriber. Please do that. I have a YouTube channel. Not too many subscribers, not too many views, but this episode will be posted on YouTube. And YouTube is a great way to spread this show virally. If you like today's show, if you like today's information, please copy and paste the link and send it in an email to all your friends. Please spread this around. Our show notes, we have show notes over at davidfeldmanshow.com. Every article we mentioned is on my website in a very easy to read, easy to access file that's free. It's all free. While you're over there, you'll see some Amazon links. Please click on those. If you want to help out, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. I've been through that a million times with you. You should know how to do that. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.